Shalom, I'm Kahan Tazadaq, be enlightened, and this is Right Knowledge for Veil. We want to deal with the term whiteness, but first, let's define the term American. In an etymology dictionary, Webster's Unabridged 1828, it states that the true American is the natives with the coppered colored skin, not white. Now let's deal with this term white. Where did this term come from, white people? But don't believe me, go and check it out for yourselves. This term was literally first used in 1613 in a play. Whiteness is a modern colonial invention. It was derived in the 17th century and used to provide the logic for genocide and slavery. Now you may not like it because you're unlearned and you suffer from cognitive dissonance. And to add on to that, you also suffer aphasia. It's called aphasia. So the first recorded mention of white people, historians concur, is in an English playwright by Thomas Middleton in 1613, The Triumphs of Truth. Now, since then, the 17th century, people crossed the world from New Zealand to India to Morocco to the Dominican Republic to Puerto Rico have been, and so on and so forth, has been variously granted or denied rights on the basis of deemed being white or non-white. If you was non-white, you were screwed and still are many chances today. Now, this is not racism. This is educational. Be enlightened. Whiteness thus has consistently entailed opposition, power, and subjugation. Research shows that this theme of whiteness as a power and unity has persisted even as boundaries of whiteness have shifted. So as European powers colonized various parts of the world, they implemented and they redefined racial categories. Prior to this, there was no racism. In colonial Barbados, 17th century, right? Labor codes discriminated against the indentured Europeans as white and gave them more rights than the enslaved Africans on that same basis. So they favored the Europeans, but you have ignorant blacks and ignorant whites that are saying, well, white people were indentured servants too. Yeah, but they had rights that the indigenous or the so-called blacks didn't have. Why did they do this? Because this ensured that the two groups would unite. Not. They ensured that they would not unite in rebellion against the wealthy planters. So as African-Americans, so-called African-American studies experts, Edward Rugmer has argued, this also codified racial discrimination as a tool of mastery. And it was replicated in Jamaica and South Carolina. Now, crucially, it hinged on the fact that the enslaved black people had no legally recognized rights, whereas European-born white servants did. You see, it's not the same. Your ignorance is not bliss. Slave status was for life. I reiterate, slave status were for life. Right? I'm sure you agree there. Without recourse and without heritability. So in other Caribbeans and Latino colonies, the term white gradually replaced the term Christian. Right? Because they also slave you in the name of their religion. So it replaced the term Christian as the designation for European settlers. Now in Haiti, the French colony officials that group people into an array of categories that codified race, class, and grants, right? So they had blacks for big black, big whites, parents for little whites, and free colored and slaves, with the over-wrenching distinction between whites and non-whites. So you have the Spanish and the Portuguese colonizers, right, in Latin America. So meanwhile, they develop this intricate and rigid coastal system. So at the top of this castle-based hierarchy, where the peninsular Spaniards were, these were the people from the peninsula. And at the bottom were the enslaved Africans. Whites also used this as a political tool as well. So what has made whiteness such an enduringly powerful tool is its nonsense logic, right? It's ill-defined as a label. It could actually have actually been defined in whatsoever way that best serves to consolidate the powers for the ruling group. So echoing the division between the enslaved people and the indentured servants centuries earlier, the working class of people in the 20th century was actually pitted against one another by the appeals to white. And you still do this today. This is why you bleach your skin. This is why you straighten your hair. Women of all nations try this. So in the 1995 book, How the Irish Became White, American historian Noel looks at the 19th century Irish immigration to the United States, and he details how this working class of newcomers emphasized their distance from so-called black laborers, thereby laying claims to their whiteness. So as a radical socialist, he questioned why they effectively sided with the oppressor, the so-called white people, rather than the oppressed, the so-called black people. Now imagine how history might have actually been different had the Irish, the unskilled labor force of the North, and the slaves, the unskilled labor force of the South, been unified. Imagine that. So whiteness is also used to attack violence. As much as whiteness enables power, it also fuels anxiety, power. People who find themselves in this category has consistently been at great pains to protect it. So historically, and still today, see, in the minds of many of those who stand most to benefit from it, whiteness must be kept pure. For centuries, universities, schools across Europe, they formulated notions of white supremacy through their knowledge production and dissemination. The Swedes taught that every living being could be categorized and classified into types. The Germans naturalized the claim that human beings are divided into five scientific races based on their skull shape, with the Caucasian skull as the most handsome and becoming. In India, Heyday, the scientific racism colonial science argued that ethnicity and caste were physical attributes assigning hierarchy status and privileged proximity to whites. And so, as scientific racism becomes more mainstream, whiteness as naturalized and framed as common sense for generations of students. So even more sinister was the political and social programs that whiteness justified, like eugenics, forced sterilization, and genocide. So in the 20th century, the humanitarians and the social sciences, too, were agents of white supremacy. Sociology sought to explain modern by universalizing the experiences of European and North American societies, while either depicting so-called Africans and Asian societies as primitive or writing them out of history altogether. This later point is very crucial. So white people and white institutions has long centered their experiences, imagining them to be universal. Universalizing their experiences, in turn, has permitted white people to speak of themselves as individuals who are unmarked by race or racism. And this stands in contrast to the way in which non-whites and so-called black people are collectively othered and racialized, and it continues to have tangible and often terrible daily consequences. Universities and schools oppose white central, not oppose, impose white centric curriculums and uniform policies that discriminate against so-called black pupils. Officers over police so-called black communities in the name of law and order. Authorities adultify black children, which leads to being treated as criminals. In each case, whiteness enacts violence without being spoken. By remembering the history of whiteness, however, we might begin to address the legacies of empire and slavery. I'm Khan Tazadaq, and this has been a historical lesson on your whiteness. Be enlightened, be informed, get out of the dark. You're too light to be in the dark.